Yo, yo, what it do? Blizz D, homie. I'm hanging out with the Misfits on the Who They Want podcast. If you ain't here, you ain't about it. Blizz D, homie.
Yo, 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 you already know what it is, what it be, what it ain't, but what it really is. This is Psychedelic Chilling with the Misfits on Who They Want podcast. This is a little man of the weeb.
What it is, this your boy Captain Capo Grum on standby for the run by with the Misfits on Who They Want podcast. You ain't about it if you ain't here, so stay tuned. Grum.
Yo, 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 this is FP3 chilling with the Misfits on Who They Want podcast, the one and only. Stay tuned.
What's up, y'all? This is Lady Tasha, better known as the Duchess, and you already know I'm rocking with the Misfits on a Who They Want Entertainment podcast show. And don't forget, go and download Everything Entertainment Expo app and get blocked in. Or bow down, bitches.
Steady. Are you ready? Daddy. Are you ready? Steady. Are you ready?
Oh, man. I can't wait to be who they want.
Ooh, ha, ha. Steady, are you ready? What's going on? Steady, are you ready?
Are you ready?
What's going on?
What's going on?
Cold fresh air. All right, ladies and gentlemen, you are now tuned in to the award-winning, internationally known podcast show that does everything that they don't. You're now tuned in to Who They Want podcast. It is Who They Want Wednesday. We're going to have some real talk tonight, ladies and gentlemen. So allow me to introduce the Duchess, the second to no one, Lady Tasha.
Hey everybody, how y'all doing today? What's going on? We up right in here today, aren't we?
Right, right. And ladies and gentlemen, let's not forget we have Master Editor, Mr. A for Abled himself, Mr. On the Brain Podcast, Kyle E, in the building. You did.
What's going on, people? Happy right Wednesday. Hope everyone's
yes,
doing
happy
well.
Day. Happy hump
happy
day.
Happy hump day. Yeah.
Right, right, right. You did.
Yeah, so everybody, I hope everybody out there is fine today. Everybody's still continuing to stay safe.
Yeah, okay. Right.
All righty. So, shout out to Father MC. Father MC, man, he just sent some more tracks over. And I told him we're going to definitely get those.
He just sent some more over?
Yeah, he just hit me, send me some more today and whatnot. So that's what's up. Send me four new ones.
Did he send the drop yet?
Huh?
Did he send the drop yet?
No, calm down. He's going in the studio.
I know.
Right.
Well, you know, he got them tracks, so he sent it and everything. So, yeah, we definitely going to get that, get up in his rotations and get, so we can get those heard and stuff. So, but other than that, everybody cool, steady, you all right tonight?
You know I'm all right, love.
Mm-hmm. That's cool. Okay. All righty. All right, Kyle, you okay tonight?
I'm doing all right, aside from the weather we've been having the last couple of days. Other than that,
oh, tell me about it, Jesus!
You know, we're only a few hours away from each other. We're getting pretty much the same kind of weather.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, I know.
You know, but see, the weather. When I get the weather and everything, you know, it brings Arthur. Arthur comes bothering me.
Oh,
you know who Arthur is, right?
Absolutely.
Arthritis. He's big time. So you're young. So you know what I mean?
And oh, trust me, that has nothing to do with it. My doctors predicted arthritis for me by age 30. They were wrong, but you know,
right.
That's a whole different story. But yeah, I know what you mean though.
Yeah, yeah. So we got a nice show to y'all tonight for y'all tonight, right, Steady? Tell them about the show.
Man, you know what we got lined up. We got motivational speaker. And, you know, Arthur and just really incredible guests lined up tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to sit down with Miss Movita.
Let's not forget to mention she's a former House, set on the House of Representatives of the state of Pennsylvania.
Absolutely. Put some respect on it. You're right, Duchess. You know it. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be exclusive tonight as we have real talk with Miss Movita Johnson Harrell. You know, you did.
That's right.
That's what we do. We do everything they don't do here.
It's a real talk know, in the right? middle.
That's right. So we got her waiting in the back. So we're just going to go ahead and bring her on. You know, don't like to keep guests waiting.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Hello and welcome. How are you?
Can
you hear okay. Are you muted? Did you enable your audio?
I don't think she enabled the audio, ladies and gentlemen. Give us a brief moment to get that situated.
Okay, no problem.
You might want to shoot her an email to her to enable her audio to click to make sure her volume's up.
Yeah.
Oops. Okay, she's going to.
I'll come back in. Okay. Yeah,
absolutely. So, without further ado. What you
oh,
said,
just, wow.
What? Just what's going on?
No, nothing, nothing going on at all. You know.
I'm just having a little bit of deja vu.
I think we all having deja vu at this moment.
Yeah, deja vu. Oh, yeah, definitely. Deja vu. But, and it's funny because we was looking at his show earlier, and I think just listening to the audio he was on, he had the same issue. You know
yeah,
what I mean? Oh, you was looking at the show earlier too, his other show?
I think it's just something with his
equipment. Oh, we had the same issue on another show. Oh, shoot.
On the show he's on right now. That's even if it's still going on right now. I don't know.
Oh wow.
Yeah. So the audio issue. I don't know. You know, a lot of people they don't remember that they have to enable the sound. Right before you come in, it tells you to enable the camera and enable the audio. So right, a lot of people, I guess they don't pay attention to that. Maybe
notification because if you don't pay attention to it, it'll disappear on you quick.
Right, yeah. It will disappear on you quick.
Since we started doing this, I haven't seen the notifications on my end. It's already all the settings are already saved the way I want them. I want them. But say this was a Zoom call, Zoom would ask each time, allow the audio, allow the video, you know.
Okay. Got you. Okay. Oh, well, you know what? Hopefully she'll be back soon. But anywho, what we got going on the Steady Files while we're waiting for our special guest to get back on?
Steady Files this Wednesday, ladies and gentlemen. What is on the lineup, guys? What's interestingly trended to kind of give a few moments of conversational piece? Right now, I'm drawing a blank because it's homecoming season. So it's kind of in that middle of my mind is on. Festivities and the fair coming to town. So
I'm about to say, you're down
in Florida, so you want to get hit with all them college goings and everything. And so Jelly Bean just got back from Morgan State. She was down there for the homecoming down there, down in Maryland. So yeah, y'all gonna get down. We got some people on the block. Hey, we see y'all. They on the block. We streaming everywhere tonight, y'all. So
shout out to the audience wherever you're checking in from.
Absolutely, shout out to all y'all.
Facebook, Apple Music, Spotify, iHeart, in the block. You know, y'all go sign up on the block. Wait. That's my social media site for us.
Mm-hmm.
Buy us for us. So go and support and sign up on that. We don't know where Mark Zuckerberg getting ready to go. Yeah. any more mess on that? Any more information on him?
No, but who recently said their piece about it? The people behind TikTok TikTok and Snapchat. They wanted to let people know, we don't do what supposedly they don't do. They don't do what Facebook's been doing. They're letting them know it's your privacy is safe up there. I don't completely trust them.
Wait a minute. I'm sorry, Kyle. You saying that? Who said this now? Instagram?
Not Instagram, because Instagram is owned by Facebook.
Owned by Facebook.
Yeah, but the people behind Snapchat and at least the U.S. side of TikTok, they had to say their piece on it, on this too, because social media platforms are on the chopping block, right? So they wanted to make sure people knew that they're not doing everything that Facebook's doing, basically. Like in a nutshell, that's basically what
they can tell us that all we want to, but you know,
exactly.
Just take that one angry employee to come out with some disgruntled employee to come out with some information, as we know what happened to Mark Zuckerberg. Lady Tasha, I'm going to come to your house and play the Madeline under your window. Okay, who is this? Who is this? Because you know, I get a lot of weird messages from people. I don't know. Somebody's talking about they're coming to my house. You're so fine. Well, thank you so much for the comment, whoever you are. I'm flattered, but please don't come to my house. I don't know who you are. We never met, so please don't tell me you come to my house. What is that? He's going to play under my window, though.
He said he's going to play Madeline under the under your window.
Oh, okay.
Right.
Well, send me a recording of it via social media. Don't go out your way to come to my house, hon. Oh, it's a good. It's a little guitar.
Oh, a mandolin.
A mandolin. Okay, a little guitar. Yeah. Oh. Just send a recording through social media, and I get it. Don't go out your way to come to my house, hon. Okay.
He's gonna play a mandolin.
That's so nice of you, though.
That's going way back.
And the thing about it, let me tell you something. Dr. DJ DG King, that's his name. I wear my bulletproof vest. So he's telling me he's gonna take the chance anyway and come out and wear his bulletproof vest. But it's funny he said that. Now, what century did that Madeline come out? Because I'm a big 19th century fan. Everybody know I'm
that predates. Yeah, that predates that. When we're talking Madeline, we're talking medieval times.
Wow, okay. You have Middle Evil sounds. Well, see, I like ancient stuff like that. I'm a big, because every day, you know, I watch Little House on the Prairie every day still. Mm-hmm. I record it. I'm a big fan of, like, you know, anything from the 19th century. Anyway, but thank you so much.
Right. We appreciate your love and support for Lady Tasha, the Duchess, right. Okay? But she good, all right? Let that be clear here, okay? All right.
Okay, and how's our guest doing? Did she get back up?
Yeah, she's ready for us, ladies and gentlemen.
Okay, so let's bring Movita back in.
Absolutely.
Hi, Movita.
Hi, y'all. I apologize for the technical difficulties.
Oh, no, that's no. Don't,
quite all right.
No, don't worry
quite
all right. It.
Y'all funny. I was back here enjoying the show.
Well, you know, we try to make it a little live for our audience. Yeah. And stuff, we was all over.
Absolutely.
Well, welcome to the show. Thank you so much for taking time out of your schedule and coming to chit chat with us. Oh, damn, Movita. Movita, you got a comment. Somebody who wants to come play a guitar under my window, he's also saying you're fine. I just want to let you
know. Girl, we both fine. I'm good with that. Thank you.
Right, I told him not to go out his way either. Come to play a guitar for me either. So, anywho, well, thank you so much for coming on.
Right.
Okay, and how have you been? How's state life been treating you since all this COVID stuff and everything?
Thank y'all for inviting me on the show. Mm-hmm. And life has been crazy,
right?
But that's been my life. So
right. I hear that. So since everything that we're going to get into in a little while and stuff, but you're working on a book right now. Is that correct?
No, actually, my book launched on September 20th.
Oh, it launched. Oh, it did. Nice.
And that would have been my son Charles's 29th birthday. And in 5 hours of the launch, it became an Amazon number one new bestseller.
Congratulations on that. Please give us some class for that. Congratulations. That is just awesome. That is awesome. Okay, so for our audience who's now just tuning in and starting to learn about you, can you just tell them the name of the book and what it's about?
Absolutely. The name of the book is Phoenix Ascending, My Rise from the Ashes, and it is actually a memoir. I've led a very, very interesting life. Mm-hmm. And I started writing this memoir about 28 years ago.
Okay. All right.
Started writing it about 28 years ago.
Wow.
I started writing this book. I was in an active crack addiction. I got clean on September 15th, 1994. So I just celebrated 27 years in recovery.
Congratulations on that. I give you all the flowers for that right there.
Yes.
Thank you. So up to that point, I had been through some really traumatic situations in my life. And something in my head said that you need to start writing it down, right? So I went back to my earliest memory, which was actually domestic violence. And I started writing from there. I was about 4 years old. And I started writing for there, and I wrote all the way up until that time, which was a little after my only brother was murdered. And I started putting it all down. I just had a pen and a composition book, and I just started writing. And in a sense, it was therapeutic for me. I literally got clean a year later.
Wow. Wow. So you, in this book, you said you took it all the way back to domestic violence. And you said that started at the age of 4.
Yeah. So that's my earliest memory. My earliest memory is actually the day that my mom started to fight back.
Okay. Right? So this wasn't domestic violence against you. It was domestic violence you witnessed your mother go through.
Yeah, I witnessed my mom go through it, and her and my dad would fight really bad to the point where they would both have black eyes the next day. But a little after that, I started being molested. I was molested as a child. Mm-hmm. Okay. So I wrote all of that down, right? Mm-hmm. And my father was actually murdered in 1975 on Easter Sunday. And me and my two siblings, my brother was 2 years older than me. He was 10. I was 8, my little sister was 4, and we had just come from my grandfather's house from Sunday dinner, mm-hmm. and two men ran up on our front porch and shot my father in the chest with a double barrel shotgun.
Now, how old was you again?
It was 21 days before my 9th birthday.
Before your 9th birthday.
Yep. So I was diagnosed at a very early age with PTSD and depression. My brother, who was he had just turned 11, wound up with behavioral health issues. Of course, he was traumatized. And, you know, they didn't have victim services for Black families back then. Right. So they labeled him with oppositional defiance disorder. And he then began to cycle in and out of juvenile homes and then in and out of adult correctional facilities. And on July 1st, 1991, he was murdered as his 5-year-old son sat in his lap over a girl.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Oh, wow. Yeah. So that I mean, that's a lot. That's heavy.
That is a lot. And given that we're in Domestic Violence Awareness Month, I gotta we have to acknowledge that. Rest in peace to those members of your family.
Right.
You know, I'm going to say rest in power. Rest in power to the people in your family that have fallen.
Okay. Right. So maybe
when we talk about domestic violence, so a lot of people don't look at women as perpetrators of domestic violence, but because of what I saw at a very young age, I developed this get them before they get you mentality. And I was very abusive to the men in my life.
Right. So, so you started off during your childhood, you was witnessed domestic violence between your parents, then you was also molested. So now as we get older, at what age did you start, did you get involved with drugs?
So there was a running joke in my family that my family used to put wine and beer in my baby bottle and blue weed in my face. So I literally come from 5 generations of addicts, 5 generations of poverty. And that Sunday, that Easter Sunday, when my father was shot, I literally picked up a drug of my own free choice.
Well, at the age of 9?
At the age of 8. Yeah, it was right before my 9th birthday. Yeah.
And what drug was that?
Alcohol. That's always been my drug of choice. Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. And alcohol.
Right. And of course, you being a minor, knowing you wasn't supposed to have it, this is something that you were just doing, you know, secretly, correct?
So what happened was my brother actually brought it in the room to me. But it was very, like, I was sitting at the table with my grandparents at the age of 12, and I was able to drink, right? Mm-hmm. It was normal in my family. My mother was my best friend. Every drug I've ever tried, my mother was the first person to give it to me. So it wasn't until I got older that I realized, like, other families don't live like this, right? This ain't normal. But it was quite natural for me to use. I was, you know, we talk about nature versus nurture with addiction. And not only was I predisposed to it through heredity, but it was in my environment. It was just a matter of time.
Right. So basically, it was hereditary.
Mm-hmm. And it was easily accessible.
Easily accessible because people within your own family were doing it and not stopping you from doing it. So it was easy for you to just
go about your business thinking that this was the normal thing.
Yeah.
That was your normal.
That was my normal.
So, Movita, what age was you when you, because you said your mother's the one who introduced you to every drug that you actually took. What age was you when you, I guess she introduced you to crack?
Yep.
And what age was that?
I was 19.
19.
Hmm. Yep. I was 19 and I literally spent 9 years in an active crack addiction. And it was hell.
Hmm. Well, at any point, did you seek like any type of rehab or anything for it? Or
yes,
like, you and your mom together, maybe?
You know what the thing is? So I used to do what they call foxhole prayers, right? I sold a lot of drugs growing up. I dropped out of high school at 11th grade to sell drugs to take care of my family. And I did a lot of foxhole prayers, like, God, if you get me out of this one, God, just please help me. Like, just please help me, right? Mm-hmm. And when the help came, I understood it was God. And that was September 14th, 1994. You know, the smoke began to clear and there were these four children. And my children were 2, 3, 4, and 8. And I remember wanting so much better for them than I had given them. Because at this point, I lived in the family home. It was a 3-bedroom home. But me and my four children lived out of one room in filth and squalor. I had no running water, illegal electric, and I could peel the dirt off the bottom of my feet with my fingernails. And I did not know how I got there. And the rats had even made their way up from the basement. And I remember sending that foxhole prayer up. And then there was a knock on the door. Well, guess who the knock was? Child Protective Services.
To take the babies.
I was going to go with cops, but.
Oof. Yeah, but they came to take the babies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they start. So what they said was, they said, look, Ms. Johnson, we know you love your children. We've talked to your family. We've talked to your neighbors. We know you love these children, but they can't live here no more. And they said, if you do not leave this house right now, we will be taking your children. And I left. And I saw it help.
And you saw it help. Okay. And you left with your children.
I left with my children. And the woman said something to me that nobody had ever said before. She said, you might want to get help. And I said, please tell me how. And she went on to tell me that there were programs for women with children and you would be allowed to take your children in to learn how to get clean and stay clean. And I actually went into a program and took my children in with me and went into that program and have not used since.
So now we at the stage in your life where you're doing a whole complete 360, correct? You went to the University of Pennsylvania, is that correct?
I did.
Okay, and what did you study there?
I have a total of 5 degrees, the last of which is a master's in social work from Penn.
Mm. Oh, right, okay. So I guess from everything you done been through, starting off as a young child, and then you went through your addictions with drugs, and then almost had your own children taken away from you. Worked in the victims unit at the DA office, the district attorney.
Yeah, so that's many moons later. You know, so my brother was mentally ill and using drugs when he was murdered, and he was homeless. So what I did was I actually created a business to take care of people with chronic mental illness and drug addiction. And I created residential housing. And what I did was there was nobody filling a certain niche. So I took the niche. I made it mine. And I became a master for the state of Pennsylvania. And that's basically a compliance expert. So all of the black homes that they were trying to overregulate and force out of business, I began to train those homes and help them with their paperwork to keep them into business. And what happened was in the summer of 2007, my sons were 14 and 16. Mm-hmm. And they came to me and they said, Mom, we know 9 people murdered in this neighborhood. Mm-hmm. And I consulted
in West Philadelphia, correct?
That's in Philadelphia, yes.
Okay.
And I consoled my children. And when they left the room, I told my husband, it's time to go. Well, January 15th, 2008, I packed my family and I left Philadelphia. Mm. January 13th, 2011, my 18-year-old son, my baby, came back to Philadelphia to pick up his sister two boys walked up to the car I had just bought my daughter and put four bullets in my baby.
Hmm. Okay. And it's and from that point is that's when you started the organization of like Mothers Against Guns, correct?
Yes. So what I did was we started the Charles Foundation.
Right, the Charles Foundation. That's named after your son.
Yep. So okay. Charles is an acronym for Creating Healthy Alternatives Results in Less Emotional Suffering.
I love that acronym.
Right. I began to travel nationally to fight for Black and brown children, to make sure that they had the resources that they needed to be successful, to work to get the illegal guns off the street. And I went into the DA's office because I had participated in a strategy. Y'all might know about it. It's called the ceasefire model. And it's group violence intervention. It's a positive peer pressure model that uses them against one another to stop the gun violence. We did that here in Philadelphia in 2013, 2014. I was the moral voice of the community talking to these boys who were likely to kill or be killed. And in a very underfunded strategy, we had over a 35% reduction in gun violence in the first year. And you know what? They wouldn't fund it.
Wow. Wow. They
so we went to the DA's office because right. the DA, who is one of the most progressive DAs in the country, said, I'll help you fund it. So I was doing my thing in the DA's office. I was bringing millions of dollars in for victim services. But you know what my beef is with that? We should be creating less victims, not more victim services. Right.
Right. Right.
Well, see, but you know what the politics is behind that because you're a former, you're a politician. So if we don't, you know, this is going to be jobs to be lost if you go that route. You get it?
So look, we friends now. Please don't call me a politician. That's so insulting to me.
I'm sorry. I won't call you a politician.
Understood.
So let me just pause right here. And I want to ask you, at what point did you become part of the Nation of Islam?
My mother converted in 1976.
Okay, so you grew up. Okay, so she converted. So, okay, so you was born.
Yeah, I was 10 years old. She was searching for something to fill that hole when my father was murdered. So she gravitated to the Nation of Islam. So I grew up Muslim.
You grew up Muslim. Awesome. So now getting back to the point where you went into the DA's office, you became part of the victims unit. So now the four house, because you have four houses, correct?
The four houses
that you had developed for the one for the mental health.
So yeah, so when my son Charles was murdered, I didn't want to do that anymore. Like the residential stuff, I began fighting gun violence full time.
Okay.
So what I did was under the Charles Foundation, I created a program called the Philadelphia Cares Model.
Okay.
And I did that under the Charles Foundation, but I actually bought over $1.5 million into Philadelphia for that strategy. And I took that into the DA's office. Right. So I literally hired 20 co-victims of violence to run that model.
Wow. Okay. All right. So now at what point did you actually become, did you step up into the chair as a representative, House representative?
Yeah, so first of all, never wanted to be a politician, never, that was never on my to-do list, right? The thing was, we were supposed to do the GBI strategy, and the DA had my back. He was forcing the mayor to participate. We were about to do a $500,000 grant to get that strategy back up and running because the gun violence steady increasing in the city. Right. And 4 days before the submission of the grant, November 2018, the city pulled out and they made a decision to continue to fund patronage jobs and all of that stuff that wasn't working. And while the DA said, don't worry, we're going to find a way to do it. 2 months later, the party tapped me to run. January of 2019, the party tapped me to run because I was already popular in my district. Now, mind you, not all of them wanted me to run. Let me be very clear about that. But there was one specific senator who believed in me and had a say in the matter and tapped me to run. And I ran. And on March 12th, I had to run two races. right? One, because I had the party's nomination, they wanted me to just depend on them and do nothing, and then I would have never gotten into office. But then I had to run a real campaign where I had to knock doors and send out mailers and kiss the babies, as they say, right? My real campaign. And on March 12th of 2019, I won the special election in my district. It was a 4-person race. I won 66% of the vote, and I was sworn in as the first Muslim woman ever elected to the Pennsylvania legislature in any office.
Wow.
Awesome.
That's awesome. That is awesome. That's awesome. So now, while you was in office, okay, I just want to just get it clear. Was you still running these non-for-profit, the houses you have, those are your non-for-profit organizations, correct?
So, no. So two things. One, the Charles Foundation is our nonprofit. The housing organization that I created, Mecca, was a nonprofit. Mm-hmm. But what people don't realize is, and if you're alluding to the AG coming after me, what people don't realize is with any nonprofit that I've ever created, I've never solicited a penny from anybody. Mm-hmm. Every nonprofit I've ever done has been done from the muscle. I pay for my own work.
Right.
So here's the thing. When I was sworn in, I don't know if you saw, when I was sworn in, a Republican white evangelist was chosen to do my swearing in invocation. And with 55 of my family and friends sitting in the well of the house, they told me that I wasn't welcome in the House of Representatives. She literally did a fire and brimstone, praise Jesus, Muslim, you ain't welcome prayer the day that I was sworn in. And after that happened, it literally went international. I began to receive death threats. I began to receive hate mail. I was told that I wasn't going to be in office long, and I believed them. So I went right to work.
Now, let me ask you this, Movita. Do you think by any chance they actually maybe had labeled you, being the fact that you was coming in right after Vanessa Brown and she already been charged for bribery and corruption and everything?
So the one thing about, so not only, I was basically labeled because I was black,
because you were black,
and I'm a woman, right? So we call that a triple threat,
right?
And with the charges against me, every lawyer that has looked at what I was charged with and that has seen the press conference that was done on me said that the two don't match. Right. So what literally happened was mistakes that I made when my son was murdered and my grief was used against me.
Okay. So wait, let's just stop right there. So just to get it clear. So you said when your son got murdered and these are the mistakes that you made because you was grieving, of course, you know, that was a mother's pain. But these were mistakes that you made within when you was, I guess, running the non-for-profits. Is that correct?
Yes. Okay. And here's the thing. He was screaming to the top of his lungs, political corruption. Of course, to carry my head around as a trophy. There was no political corruption. I wasn't what I was charged with in office was making a mistake on a campaign finance report. It wasn't even a financial mistake. It was a reporting mistake. Right. So there was no political corruption.
Right, because they basically had said that you had actually, to support your campaign, you took money, I guess, out of the non-for-profit, correct?
That's what he said. That's not true.
That's what he said, right. I mean, that's not accurate. That's not true at all.
Yeah, exactly.
It's not true.
Okay. All right. Okay.
And what people need to realize is I was just another black person coming through the criminal justice system.
Right.
Mm. It didn't matter. In fact, it made it worse that I was a state representative. It made it worse that I was out of West Philly that's being highly gentrified. It made it worse that I was screaming at the top of my lungs to save black and brown people. It made it worse that I was trying to save black and brown kids from dying from gun violence. They hated me.
Right.
And they still do.
Right. Now, let me ask you this question. How was they able to tie in... because I guess the houses you had, there was a monthly rent due on them, okay? And I guess the people you had in the houses, they was, and this is what they said, the accusations, that the Social Security benefits they was getting and the Medicaid benefits they was getting, you was taking those using to pay the bills and it wasn't going to the residents. Is that correct?
It's not correct.
That's not correct. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, did I say it wrong, or it's not correct on their side?
It's not correct on their side.
On their side. Okay, I just wanted to make sure that I was just quoting it correctly, but that's what they tried to say you was doing, correct?
Correct.
Okay.
But they were trying to, what they were trying to say that I was doing was that I was stealing the public's money.
The public's money, correct. From there, that's Medicaid and Social Security. It's not correct. Okay. So what made them try to associate you in doing that? Like, where did they start with that? Like, what was they able to tie that into? You understand what I'm saying? I'm just like,
great question.
As I said, they took a bunch of documentation errors and criminalized me for it. And I'm really not supposed to be going into detail about this, because the whole point is I came on to promote the book, but the thing is, I wanted to put this in my book and I couldn't.
Wow.
I literally was gagged. Nobody's heard my side of the story.
Right.
And it will be in the second book, so we can have this conversation when the other book comes out in April.
Absolutely.
Oh, absolutely.
Absolutely. So, going forward, right? Because we know everything that they brought up against you and charged you for. All right. And the last thing, question about this, and then we get more into other details and stuff. You actually pled guilty. Is that correct?
I did.
Okay. Now, your legal team, what was the reason for them to tell you to plead guilty, though? You know,
I pled guilty to protect my family. Like I said, I'm no different than any other Black person that comes through the criminal justice system. And they will use against you what they want to use against you to get the end result. And the end result was for me to take a guilty plea. And I lost a child to the grave. I wasn't about to lose one to a prison.
Right. Mm-hmm. And doing it in the midst of this, because you actually came in, they made you do 3 months. After you came out, then you had your another son who actually got into, I think he was shot. Is that correct?
That's correct. My son Dante went to California in March on a weekend trip and was shot and killed in a random drive-by.
So moving on from all of that, because that's just a lot. You came up from a very horrific childhood. Okay. Mm-hmm. You turned yourself around with your kids and with your children and everything. And, you got a crown. I mean, you just wear your crown, because that is just remarkable. Okay. Then you came into and sat down with the House of Representatives, got involved with a lot of non-for-profit organizations that you actually created.
No, you're wrong.
I
didn't get involved with non-for-profits when I was in the House of Representatives. I wasn't even working with any of the nonprofits when I was with the House of Representatives. I had stopped working with the nonprofits in 2017 before I even went to the DA's office.
Gotcha. Okay, and listen,
that's the distortion of the truth.
Right.
And here's the thing, that's the problem when people read stuff that's been put in the media, because the media is one-sided. Nobody has written my side of the story. Nobody's heard my side of the story, because I was literally gagged. And it also doesn't say I didn't do 3 months. I did 2 months, and I went into the House of Correction, and I made that choice. I did what I needed to do to protect my family. And I ain't even mad about that. I did what I needed to do to protect my family. But the flip side of that is I went into the House of Correction, and after two of me being there, the women in the facility elected me to be their block rep. So when COVID hit and the prison shut down and those women weren't getting shower time and phone calls and no information from their attorneys, because I have a relationship with the district attorney and I have a relationship with the Defenders Association, I was able to get on the phone with my husband and the DA to get answers to legal questions that nobody else could get. I was able to make sure that those women could get their shower time, make sure that those women could call their children. And in the process, I got COVID. I came home with full-blown COVID. But you know what? I got my sense of taste back and my sense of smell back on April 20th, the day before my first birthday. And by May 5th, I was back on the street doing everything that I've always done, which is protect the community. I had fed over 150,000 people from a street corner in West Philadelphia. I have paid children to not participate in gun violence. Right now, I have a power crew where we pay young people. All of my young people have been affected by gun violence. Four of them have been shot. Some of them have been shot at. All of them have been affected by gun violence because we're still at the same place we were before I went to the House of Representatives, because this is what they want for our children.
Right.
Right. And this is why we have you on here, not to just go back to things and stuff, but because this is the stuff they don't report. You get what I'm saying? And this is why we have you on it, so you can let us know, you know, all the things that they're not reporting and stuff. And again, like I say, I commend you. So now, where are you at right now as far as like, are you still doing the guns against guns violence campaigning, I guess?
So yes, so that GBI strategy that I went up to Harrisburg to get the money for as a six month freshman with no history in politics, didn't know what the hell I was doing. I bought back $1.3 million for gun violence prevention. I bought back over $5 million in community improvements for my district. So that GBI strategy just started going on right now in Philadelphia.
Right. That's awesome.
I still fight gun violence. I work directly with the people most likely to kill or be killed. In fact, I'm going in. I have to go into a school tomorrow to talk to the target group. The kids are doing the shootings. So I work directly with the shooters.
Right, right, right. Now, is this something here? Because right now it's just in Philadelphia. Do you see yourself down the line getting to try to take this national?
I'm already national.
Oh, you are national with it. So are you going
around the country doing this?
Okay.
Excellent.
Excellent. Okay. Wow. So now, are you going to go around the country also with your book as well? That's what you're doing too with the book?
That's actually what I'm doing right now.
Okay. And so where can we look to find you and what city's coming up and everything?
I don't have my calendar in front of me because I'm on the phone with y'all, but I will be in Princeton University on Friday. I'm headlining with Sean King. We're doing a criminal justice reform event. Sold out already. Then I will be in Chicago on Saturday. I am a keynote for a women's empowerment, over 350 women. So the calendar's filling up.
Right, right. So I have one comment for you. And I actually spoke to this young man myself, and he's going to be on the show soon. Have you ever heard of Ricky Banks?
I think I heard that name before.
Right. He's the young man who got shot and lost his sight and everything. He's from Harrisburg, being that you said that you went up there. There was a big write-up on him, and he's in Harrisburg, PA. So he's going to be on a show, too. He had lost his sight because, and he was shot and everything. So now, with everything you done been through, right, can you look back and just look at any point in time? And I'm not talking about as far as the drug use and everything, because that started young. I'm talking about as far as like when you actually started, like, and I don't want to say political career because you don't like being called a politician. But at that point in time, when you started working for like the victims and everything and help protecting them on the DA, is there anything you would have done different?
Nope. Nothing.
Right. Mm.
You know what? I've saved thousands of young people.
Right.
So if this is the path that God chose for me, and you know what? If people buy the book, they will see the foreword is written by a guy named Hassan Freeman. Hassan Freeman did 15 years in jail for attempted murder. Hassan Freeman was my partner along with Brian Lentz for the Focus Deterrence Strategy, which is the strategy that I fought for the last 5 years of my life to get funded because I saw it work. I saw it, how it transformed those young people. I saw when the police said that there were certain young men that would never put the gun down and come off the streets, and they were the first ones to call in for help. Hassan wrote my foreword, and he calls me a hero. And he wrote the story about a hero's journey. And he wrote the story about heroes. Real heroes are typically persecuted because they are heroes. And, you know, something that was really deep for me was when I came home from jail, my cousin is Tone Trump, the international rapper. My cousin came to my house after I got up off my back from COVID, and he sat on my couch and he cried. And I said, why are you crying? And he said, because I'm glad you escaped with your life. He said, because people like you who are really for the community, listen, I've never received a penny to fight gun violence, ever. Right. I buried people's children out of my pocket. All of the things that we do through the Charles Foundation, me and my family paid for. It's never been about money for me. I was told as a Black woman that I shouldn't have been walking those cobblestones in the Capitol with my red bottoms on. I was told that I shouldn't own fur coats, that I shouldn't have a nice house. Someone was asked, is her house ornate? Hell yeah, my house is ornate. I worked my ass off for everything that I have. Nobody ain't never gave me nothing. Would I do it all again? Absolutely, because the numbers of children, I walk through Home Depot and this young man working in Home Depot, is that you, Miss Mo? And they walk up to me and hug me and thank me for saving their lives. Mm-hmm. Right. The only thing I would change is I want my sons back.
Right. No, I hear you. Right. Whew. Wow. Well, we're about to go on a commercial break for a minute. Okay. And when we get back, we're going to talk some more with you. Thank you so much for just, you know, coming on and voicing everything. And we got some more talking to do with you. So we're about to go to a commercial break right now.
Okay.
Hey, I'm Alistair Boxhill, and I'm both passionate and committed to helping you win through understanding the power of credit and your own financial literacy. See, financial literacy wasn't something that I was taught in school. I had no idea what made up my personal credit score, or what the proper credit utilization was, or even what the impact of me not paying my bills on time would have on my credit scores. As a result, I suffered with bad credit for a very long time. I just couldn't get out of my own way. You know, I was never the person that didn't make money. I've always been a go-getter. But the lack of knowledge and the tools really had a huge impact on me. I'm definitely a testimony that you can overcome bad credit. I've personally had repossessions along with various collections accounts removed from my credit profile, which has allowed me to get my buying power back. Today, I'm passionate about helping you to win and to overcome your bad credit and to take charge of your financial future. That bankruptcy, that repossession, those medical bills, those student loans, it does not have to define you. If you're ready for change and to take charge of your financial future, I'm ready to work with you. Connect with me on social media, on Instagram, Alistair Boxhill, on Facebook, Alistair Boxhill, or you can email me at alistairboxhill@gmail.com for a free consultation. Looking forward to working with you.
All right, welcome back, everyone. That's our own Alistair on everything with his credit repair services and everything. So, Movita, I just want to ask you, you know, all of this, this had to mentally, and like, at any point going through all of this, did it like almost mentally and physically break you down?
What part? The arrest? No.
Right.
No. Right. Listen, when you know you have a target on your back, but you know that your life is being lived with a purpose, I said, I can eat anything they throw at me. Right. And I did.
Right.
They tried to leave me destitute, but God had otherwise. So, no, I knew there was a target on my back. I knew that they were coming for me. But you know what? I went and I did exactly what I said I was going to do.
Right. So now the all your other ventures and everything that you're working towards, like, what impact does like everything that happened have on that? I mean, how difficult? Are you running into like any speed bumps that's just making it difficult for you to go on with things you want to do, including like promoting your books or starting any other you know, organization is, or you just
it's not getting in my way. Here's the thing. For the people who love me, they didn't need an explanation. For the people who didn't, there would be no explanation good enough. So the one thing people know about me is that, first of all, you can't come to me with no nonsense. That ain't the type of person I am. And while people may say whatever they want behind my back, they ain't gonna say it to my face. I just keep it moving. That doesn't define me. Listen, no white man gets to define who I am.
Right.
He doesn't get to define who I am. My integrity speaks for itself. My work speaks for itself. No, it hasn't blocked me. I'm on supervision. It hasn't blocked me. I keep it moving.
Right, right. So, you know, we know all, because, you know, we know this whole Wikipedia thing on Google and everything, it's never accurate. You know, you got people that can come in and edit stuff. If you were to do your own wiki for somebody to look back, like maybe a century from now, and study a Movita Johnson Harrell, what would you want that wiki to say, like, in maybe in two or three sentences about your life?
That I fought for my community. That's it. And here's the thing that's already in there. It's just right now covered up by all the smoke and mirrors. There's about 60 pages of me on Google. Mm. So you know what? I'm going to use that negative press to my advantage. Mm.
Right.
As my husband says, there's no such thing as negative press. I don't agree. But you know what? Before that negative stuff happened, I was already in the press. My good work was already in the press. Me calling people out was already in the press. Me going to Harrisburg and going to Washington and going across this country fighting for black and children, black and brown children, was already in the press. So I am who I am, and my integrity speaks for itself.
Right.
And basically, that's your powerful force. And basically, it's like it seems like it scared them. You understand what I'm saying? So they had to come out with all this other, you know, stuff to come at you with all these accusations and stuff.
They and still scared.
Say that will scare somebody, a powerful black person.
They still scared.
Right.
And on top of that, I was touring the country in 2019 with Congresswoman Ilhan Omar. And when that Congresswoman stood on a stage in Washington, D.C. and said, I'm going to find a way to bring her to Washington, I knew I was out. I knew I was out. Like, yeah. And it's okay. And here's the thing for me, my son had been dead 9 years and I had not sat down. And God sat me down. And he warned me before it was, listen, I knew it was coming. And I knew I was going to have to sit down for a minute. And I accept it. I accept everything that goes along with my journey.
Yeah, I can feel that just over here. Like, I know we're not in the same room, but just your words alone it's left me speechless, for lack of a better word. But at the same time, I'm very grateful to be talking to you right now. So what about so you're currently working on the second book, right?
I am.
And you already have a release time frame for April of 2022. So are we expecting more of, like, is this basically a part two, or is this something else?
No, this is a part two. So actually, this first book goes from my earliest memory, which is that of domestic violence, until after my son Charles's trial. And I actually asked for mercy for the two young men that murdered my son. And I wanted to include everything that has happened in the past 2 years and after the trial. But my attorneys advised otherwise. And now I have to wait for people to look at things and make sure that I'm not breaking any confidentialities or putting myself in further jeopardy. And they are looking out for my best interest. So I made a conscious decision not to include it in this book. So my second book will be out on my son Dante's birthday, which is April 30th. And it will be from my son Charles's after my son until current.
Okay. What the fuck is over there?
Is that me?
Yeah.
Got a phone? Yeah. I don't know. What is that?
Yeah, that was my phone. Sorry.
Oh, yeah. Like a vibration and everything. So let me just ask you, how are you right now? I mean, like, your sons and everything. I mean, like, what, because you, it's like right now you stayed so busy right after losing your sons and stuff. I mean, have you taken any time right now just to sit back and just think and like do something for yourself, you know, just so you can just like do a woosah? Like, what do you do on woosah time? Because it's like basically,
I do. So my son, Dante, was devastated when they came for me. In fact, my whole family wanted me to fight the charges.
Right.
And my attorneys told me that I could have beat everything but the one charge, which was, they said that I perjured myself. And you see perjury, you think it's a big deal, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
They say that I perjured myself in bankruptcy court, right? So the perjury charge was, they said that I said that I don't know someone that I actually know. I got a felony charge for that. You heard me.
Wait, they said you didn't know someone, but you actually know.
You actually knew them.
That's the perjury charge.
How did they get, how?
Now, is this
so from bankruptcy court, there are transcripts. I don't even remember it, right? But there are transcripts. So the perjury charge, this goes to show you, like, you gotta read between the lines. The perjury charge is that I said that I didn't know someone that I actually knew. It wasn't that I stole something from somebody. It wasn't that I harmed somebody. It was that I said that I didn't know someone that I actually know. My attorney said that was the only charge that I probably wouldn't have beat.
Mm-hmm. Now, they said you didn't know someone who you actually knew. Mm-hmm. Now, this person who they said they claimed that you knew, and they found out, they claimed that you knew, and they found out proof that they, I guess they found proof that you did know them. Was it a relationship that could have caused like some type of conflict of interest in any of the like organizations or any time when you was you know, well, any of the houses or anything, or any transactions that might could have went down?
No.
It's just some Randall Swole Joe that they said you knew and you did say you didn't know and everything.
No. It was basically a situation where they were some people. When I got clean, I came off of welfare and off of Section 8 voluntarily. And when I went into business, I purchased a building from a friend, somebody who was my friend. What I didn't know was, and you know, most people don't realize, Black people don't typically have mentors or people to guide them through the process. So I did everything from the muscle, right? So with this person, I trusted them as my friend, not knowing that there was a clause in our agreement that they could foreclose on me for any reason that they wanted to. And I was actually trying to refinance the property. I was trying to hold the property, but investment bankers wanted it. So the friend was actually trying to help me save the property, but it wasn't anything with the property. It was just the fact that they said that I didn't, that I knew the person, or that I said that I didn't know the person and I didn't know them. But it wasn't anything fraudulent with paperwork or anything like that. But the whole point was that is the only thing that they said that I would not have been able to be, was the perjury charge. Yeah.
But why would they even care, though? That's what I'm confused about. Why would they even care? Because basically what this is sounding like is, this is sounding like, you know, I'm telling somebody I like a strawberry lollipop, and then later on they say, no, you said you like the lemon, remember? And I said, no, I like the strawberry. So I mean, I don't know how to either, like, why would they care if you knew this person? Like, was this person supposed to go, well, did they actually help you refinance this place or something?
No, we wound up not doing anything. So here's the thing, do y'all know what techno lynching is?
First time I've heard that.
So there's a new form of lynching for powerful Black people.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
And what they do is they kill your name and they kill your reputation. And that was the intent.
Okay, now that term.
We were actually talking about my son. So, right. My son Dante was so upset when all of this happened, and he begged me. My husband begged me not to take the plea, but I made a decision to take the plea because I didn't want them coming after my family in any form or fashion. Right. I said I can eat whatever they throw at me. Right. Really, I can eat it all. Bring it, and I took it. But my son was so upset, you know, people were coming at me on social media and I had to tell him, don't respond, like, don't go toe to toe with people. And he was my biggest cheerleader with this book. Many days I'd be at the kitchen table writing and he would just sit across from the table just to be in the same space with me. Right. I started this whole health conscious thing because my youngest daughter that my son came to pick up, stopped crying after we buried Charles 10 years ago and at 19 years old developed unmanageable hypertension. And last year on July 12th at 28 years old she went into end-stage renal failure because her hypertension has literally killed her kidneys. So I went on this whole kick to try and lose weight to give my daughter a kidney. And my, you know, if you go on my YouTube page, you'll see all these smoothie videos and me talking about giving my daughter a kidney and me going through the process of losing. They wanted me to lose 20 pounds. I lost 30 pounds. And my son would be in the room with me all the time. And he would be sitting across. And he was looking forward to the opportunity for me to tell my side of the story.
Right,
so when
right.
my son Dante got murdered, I had gotten my final edits for the book back a week before Dante was murdered. I live with something that's called broken brain syndrome. You can look it up. It's a phrase coined by Dr. Mark Hyman. And it's just when a brain absorbs so much trauma that it literally changes the neuroscience of your brain. It's like someone with dyslexia. Right. And I have broken brain syndrome and some of those mistakes that I made that I was telling you about earlier, documentation mistakes, those are common for people with broken brain syndrome. Right. So when I got those final edits back, I couldn't even read them because I had now lost a second son. So for me, my therapy was to throw myself into the work, was to do something in my child's memory, right? We created the Dante LLC, developing opportunities that nurture, teach, and empower, where we give young people skills and give them good work ethic, right? And that's what's been helpful for me, just getting back into the work because, listen, this could have killed me. Right. When Charles died, I wanted to commit suicide. Every wonderful thing I've done in my life, I've made millions of dollars. None of that matters to me. I walked away from Mecca. I made Mecca a multi-million dollar business. Mecca was made on my back. I worked two jobs to create Mecca. None of that matters to me. I can't have two of the things that I want most in this world, which is my children. So now I have to live a life where I got a co-parent for grandchildren with no fathers. So my wusa is being able to stand up every day, is being able to get out of the fetal position, put my feet on the floor, stand up, fight for my grandchildren, fight for your family members, and just make a difference in this world. What do I do to wusa? I have prayer. I'm Muslim. I pray 5 times a day. I meditate, I go and get the occasional massage, and I have a husband that loves me past all of my pain and all of my defects. I can't be more fortunate than that.
Right. I just have one last question regarding great program, great platforms or relevant. Oh, thank you. I just have one question. Now, I just want to go back as far as the houses. Like, where are they at right now today? I know you walked away from them. Is that correct? You have nothing to do with them?
I haven't had anything to do with them since 2017.
Right. Now, where are they at today, though? Are they still, does anybody else?
My oldest daughter runs Mecca.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Okay. Awesome. You had a question, Kyle? I'm sorry. I'm talking.
No. I was just gonna say salute
to your, you know, to your support system. Like your husband, your daughter, you know, your daughters, everybody who's still, you know, who's still, everybody's still with you, but you know what I mean, right? Mm-hmm. I'm trying to get my words together, but either way, yeah, that is proof that you're able to eat whatever's thrown at you, to coin your phrase.
Right.
I hope whoever's listening or watching right now, you know, who does not know your side of the story, gets to know your side of the story, finds the book, finds the information that the media will not share, and really just get to know the whole truth, because you went through a lot internally, externally, all of that, and you're still here talking about it.
Yeah, so that just goes to show tough times don't last at all, but tough people do, and that's what you're tough. You understand what I'm saying?
Right.
See, you know what I'm saying? So in shorter terms than I could have.
Yeah, tough times don't last, but tough people do. You know, so you've been through a lot since childhood, and now you coming up, you've been through a lot since adulthood, just trying to help people, you know, and give part of yourselves, and now, you know, and you're still going on, because now you're putting all of it in a book. You're letting people know, well, hey, yeah, I went through this, but, you know, I'm going to write about it and let you know, and, you know, I give you respect for that as well.
Not only that, there are mothers that reach out to me every day. There are recovering people that reach out and, I mean, DM me on social media and just thank me. Because a lot of people don't have my voice, right? And the truth of the matter is, like, I can't even take credit for it. Like, God just keeps pouring strength into me. I don't know if he's giving me my son's strength or what, but every time that I want to quiet my voice, he won't allow me to. It gets louder and it gets stronger. And I have to give God all the credit. Like, I haven't gotten through any of this. My faith is strong, you know, and God is just... he's amazing. Like, all that he continues to pour into me. And any day that I want to fold, he just lifts me back up. I spend a lot of time in the cemetery. Right. Both of my sons are in the cemetery.
Right. I get it.
Both of my sons. And neither one of them did anything wrong. Neither one of them. And my worst nightmare, and a lot of parents, Black parents' worst nightmare, I live every day. I just want to smell their skin. But the one thing that I understand is that my fight is bigger than me. Mm-hmm. I understand that my life is not my own. I understand that my life has to be one of service, because it's somebody watching me that gets strength from me every day. And there's a lot of little Black and brown children that I've saved. So guess what? I understand my reward ain't here. It ain't.
Amen.
That's the hero's journey.
Real talk.
So I noticed you said that parents are reaching out to you on social media. Can you tell everybody where they can find you at on social media, the different platforms you want?
Yep. IG and Facebook, I am MovitaJohnsonHarrell.com. Twitter, I am MovitaJH, MOVITA. They can go to my website, MovitaJohnsonHarrell.com. I'm real easy to find. It's about 50, 60 pages of me on Google. Real easy to find. Mm. That is my real cell number, by the way.
Well, everybody to come to your platforms and don't go to Google, because they come to your platforms, they get an authentic Movita.
You know, absolutely.
Google and stuff, and that's why I referenced earlier with Wiki and everything. You know, you get stuff that's almost like the Bible. You know what I'm saying? The Bible's man-made. You know, so you get what I'm saying? I mean, you know, so you know, you're gonna go to your platforms because we know that's authentic and stuff. Movita, thank you so much for coming on the show. Is there anything else you want to leave and saying and leave us with? Any message you want to get out there to everybody? Anybody, you know, mothers that's going through what you're going through, and everything as far as losing two sons, the gun violence and stuff, something that we just
cannot control
of. Is there anything you want to say?
Absolutely. So go to my website, MovitaJohnsonHarrell.com, buy my book, Phoenix Ascending, My Rise from the Ashes. I've also created a journal, you know, and I want to say, like, for parents or people going through something. So here's one of the reasons I wrote the book, because I'm not unique. People go through stuff right. each and every day, but everybody don't know how to get to the other side. You can get to the other side if I can live the life that I've lived and still be up and not in somebody's white jacket with my hands tied behind my back. Right. You know what that means.
Yep.
Right. A straight jacket.
Straight jacket.
Then anybody can get through what they're going through. Resolution leads to evolution, and evolution leads to revolution. And the last thing I want to leave with is, if you are not a part of the solution, then you are part of the problem. Save our children.
Thank you so much. Thank you. It's been a pleasure meeting you. Thank you so much for coming on our platform. Hopefully, we definitely want to get you back on when the second book come out. When is that second book going to be?
Second book drops, please.
April 30th.
April 30th? Okay, awesome. Listen, I mean, Movita, actually, we have some comments for you, Ryan. Awesome interview. Thank you for sharing the information and authentic story. You know, people are actually putting comments up for you. They're feeling you and everything, you know, because everybody goes through something, you know what I'm saying? And mm-hmm. whatnot, and somebody's, you know, story. I mean, your story and tragedy that you went through, it's definitely going to be somebody's inspiration, believe it or not. You know what I'm saying? That's
how life works. And tell your viewers to keep their eyes out. There will be a documentary in June of 2022.
And that's what I was about to say, too. A documentary, yeah, you know, so.
Murders right. That Matter by filmmaker Marco Williams. They can catch me right now in the Philly DA, the story of Larry Krasner taking over the Philly DA's office. I'm in about 6 of the 8 episodes. And then we are in talks about a movie.
Okay. And it's funny you say that, because I was just sitting here thinking that, and I wanted to ask you, but then I got the comment popped up and everything. This is a movie right here. And I have this question to ask you. Who would you want to direct this movie if you ever turned this into a movie? Well, they said this talk. Who would you want to direct? And who will you want to play you?
I would want Mary J. Blige to play me.
I can see that. I can really see that. Yes, yep. I can see that. Yep. I can really see that.
Want Viola Davis to direct it.
Woo. Viola Davis.
Now that's a combination. Now.
Oh, that's a good combination. And to honor your sons, who would you want them to play them?
To play my sons, well, Dante had a distinguishing gray patch in the front of his hair in the shape of a heart. So we would need to get somebody amazing. I don't know. I didn't get at any thought.
probably a newcomer, maybe.
Somebody up and coming, yeah, to give them some recognition.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you see how off the back you came up and said Mary J. Blige to play you? These are your babies. So I know it will probably take you a long time to try to filter out, like, who can play my babies?
No, you know who could play them? Two of my grandsons. Charles's only son was born 26 days after he died. He's like, Charles spit him out. Mm. And my grandson, Chad, could play Dante. Mm.
Mm. Wow. No.
And it's going to be a play next year of my life, of my advocacy.
Really?
Oh, wow.
Well, that's
in fact, I was supposed to get on the call with them at 9:00. That's who was calling in.
Well, you know what? Go ahead and get on your call.
Go ahead, do what you
Thank you
do.
So much and everything for being on with us tonight. We look so forward to having you back on the show. With your books, we're going to be definitely looking out for your books. Y'all heard it. She gave you her social media platforms. Definitely follow her. Listen, join the Block, Everything Entertainment Expo. That's a social media platform. Me, myself, for women, Black women created. By us, for us. It's just like Facebook and Instagram. So go on, definitely. We love you to share your story on that platform as well. Okay.
And Movita, thank you so much.
Good luck with everything. Blessings, nothing but blessings to you and your family. Okay. And you just keep pushing them. Okay.
Thank you. Thanks for having me on, y'all. Peace.
You're very welcome.
Bye-bye. Okay. Wow. Oh my God. Okay.
So we're going to take a commercial break and we're going to get into one of Father MC's new tracks doing a commercial. DJ Steady, can you do that for us, huh? I mean, we need something, right? We need something right now. Can you do that for us right now? Just put on something. He sent some new tracks over to me. Legendary rapper Father MC. He was on the show on Monday, Iconic Monday episode. And he just got a whole thing going on with his whole album project, Black Disney. and his artists and stuff, and he sent some more tracks over today. So we're going to get into one of them doing our commercial breaks. I'll let the DJ choose because that's what the DJ does. So DJ Steady, are you ready?
Go ahead. Let's get into this commercial break then. I got you.
Okay.
Peace, family. This is your boy, Dr. Garfield Bright from the R&B group Shy. Listen, I'm just here to tell you that you are not rocking with the best unless you're rocking with the Who They Want podcast. Period. Right? Any content revolving around entertainment, you got to pull up. This is your go-to place, Who They Want. And if you really, really need to gain access and you're serious, you need to download the Everything Entertainment Expo app. And after you do that, you need to sign up on the block. Right? Let's go into motion. Let's make it happen. Let's be about it. All right? Talk to y'all soon. I'm saying salute. Garfield from the group Shy, signing off.
Yeah, I'm on my New York shit. Yeah, yeah, we move on shit. I'm back way over. Yeah, I'm on my New York shit. Yeah, I'm on my New York shit. Yeah, yeah, we move on shit. I'm back way over. Yeah, I'm on my New York shit. Yeah, hold up, part in the intro. Intro, not them, part in the info. Flex, give me that instrumental. Kid Capri, yeah, you know what they info. Yeah, I'm gonna swag them to death, way. Bring that shorty over here, way. I'm on my New York, talk about it. Everybody in the world talk about it. Dangerous, I'm on the cusp of giving niggas a less. Everyone wanna know what I'm on. And when he came home, when I came home, yo, I ain't even in my prime yet. Nope, didn't get a sign yet. Didn't get signed yet. Cause I'm on my New York shit. Yeah, I'm on my New York shit. Yeah, yeah, we move on shit. I'm back way over. Yeah, I'm on my New York shit. Yeah, I'm on my New York shit. Yeah, yeah, we move on shit. I'm back way over. Yeah, I'm on my New York shit. I make the world seem cats hitting me up. Got broads on the low who be wanting a nut. Got hood broads calling me they priests. Cop priests. Got they niggas wanna hook me up. And that's when I get that pick me up. Hit me up. Got niggas getting out of the cut. Father MC struck. Got niggas on 10. Got mommies ready to fuck. I'm on some tight wind shit. Back at it. No freak shit, but a freak yet. Flashy, uptown, been on the black. Been on the plastic, how you like that? Mills on the card, who you know say that? Say you ring more than forget it, I'm back. I'm a sign of the time, facts. I'ma give you what you want, facts. Yeah, I'm on my New York shit. Yeah, yeah, we move on shit. I'm back way over. Yeah, I'm on my New York shit. Yeah, I'm on my New York shit. Yeah, yeah, we move on shit. I'm back way over. Yeah, I'm on my New York shit. Yeah, I'm on my New York shit. You on your New York shit. Yeah, we on our New York shit.
Nice pick, right, DJ.
That's big up to Farm MC.
Absolutely.
Yeah, big up to him. That was that's New York shit. Y'all gotta be from New York to understand how that feels, how this is about. Oh gosh.
Tonight was powerful, and it's gonna take me a while to process everything. But can I ask my fellow host for a favor?
Sure.
Yeah, sure, anything.
Sure.
Can we all just take a breath?
And get us a little woosah period going here.
Yeah, because I think we all needed the comments were blowing up for a little, you know, for a little bit. And I had just noticed one right before we went into that last commercial break. It got me. So she says my 18-year-old cousin was shot point blank in the chest last night. Thank you for sharing.
That's my cousin. I got to find out who that is. Ronnie said that's my cousin saying that. I got to find out who that was. I'm my relative. Oh, wow.
Yeah, it had just popped up right before we had signed off with the guest. And So, yeah.
Well, ladies and gentlemen.
Everybody.
Shout out to that. So with that being said, ladies and gentlemen, I hope y'all enjoyed this iconic, powerful, inspirational, motivational, you know, any good positive work. Like when I said it was going to be real talk, ladies and gentlemen, I ain't expected to get that real in the talk.
Oh, and I got.
I told you I was going to ask some questions.
Yeah, no, you did. You did, but a lot she answered right before you started asking.
Well, because she knew. She knew.
Absolutely.
She already had it. Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. So, with that being said, ladies and gentlemen, y'all stay tuned. We got some more shows lined up. Y'all enjoy y'all night.
Peace out, y'all. Thanks for
Peace.
Chiming in. Thanks, everybody. I had a few family members that chimed in. Everything, people on the block, people on the YouTube. Thank you all over. Appreciate y'all. See you tomorrow.
Get it.